Coming up on Need to Know, there are 4 seats up for grabs in the Rochester City School Board this election season. But there are no Republicans on the ballot, nor on the current board for that matter. How does a lack of political diversity on school boards affect urban education? That's just ahead. Also on the show, they've served as one of film great Martin Scorsese's biggest inspirations in movie making. Now they're coming to Rochester. The history, the stories, and the impact of Polish cinema. And take everything you thought you knew about carving a pumpkin and toss it out the window. Wait until you see the jack-o'-lanterns bringing tourists from around the world to the Hudson Valley. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. When you hit the polls on November 3rd, if you live in the city of Rochester, you'll see an obvious void when scanning the ballot and reviewing the candidates in the Rochester School Board race. There are no Republicans running for Commissioner of Schools. Turns out 2013 was the last time a Republican ran for the city school board, and the time before that was 2007. And if you ask around, not many people know the last time a Republican served on the Rochester School Board. When there's a lack of political diversity among school board members, how does that affect policies, reform measures, mandates, and ultimately the students within the district, in particular in urban education? Joining me for this conversation, Jim Bowers, a professor and the chair of the Political Science and Legal Studies Department at St. John Fisher College. Jim is also a former Rochester School Board member. And Van White, the current president of the Board of Education for Rochester City Schools. And welcome to you both.
Glad to be here.
When you hear that the number of Republicans running for Rochester School Board has gone from 3 Republicans on the ballot in 2005, fast forward a decade, there are none currently this election season. Ultimately, what does that tell us?
Well, as a political scientist, it would initially say that the Republican Party understands it simply is not competitive in the city, given the enrollment advantage that the Democratic Party has. So, you know, just in electoral politics alone, it simply means they're going to play where they have a chance of winning, and they probably have simply discounted any value to the school board elections because they're unwinnable, just like city council, just like most districts in the city for county legislature.
I invited GOP Chairman Bill Reilich to join us for this conversation because I was really interested in getting his take on this. However, I was told that the Monroe County GOP does not get involved in local school board races because of, according to the spokesperson I connected with, the high number of other races that are taking place on any given election season. However, it's not uncommon to hear that the Monroe County Democratic Party is endorsing a number of candidates specifically for the Rochester City School Board. So beyond that, because I've heard that before, you know, that notion, the city is more Democratic, the county is more Republican, so that's gonna account for the divide. Is there anything else that can account for the divide? Does the Republican platform not jive with urban education? Van?
I wouldn't say that. I got to tell you, I think there's a bit of hypocrisy here. You will see Democrats run for office in suburban districts that are largely Republican. That's healthy, I think, for those suburban districts, those suburban municipalities. In Rochester, I think, if you're going to say this is kind of crazy, I think it would actually be very healthy if they ran races, Republicans ran races, even for city school board, city council, because I think the dialogue in and of itself, I think, you know, I'm not much of a party buff, but I think one of the benefits of having a party system is the citizens, the voters, benefit from this diverse dialogue. When they walk away from that, they're preventing that dialogue. They're also preventing those of us who maybe are in the majority from hearing different points of view, which we could take in terms of operating government. I think it's really regrettable that they would not run as we Democrats run in suburban districts. Look at the towns that are controlled by throughout this region that are controlled by Republicans. Look at the county legislature. We still run, even though someone say we can't be competitive, we still run. And I think that's healthy for the democracy.
Well, go ahead.
Well, a couple of things. One, if you look in the towns, the town school board races are nonpartisan. We are the only, in the immediate area, the only partisan school board, the way it's structured. So I don't think the fact that we're the Democrats, which we both are, would run seats for the county legislature or even town board when they don't have a chance of winning is not quite the same as saying the Republicans should be doing this the same thing in the city with the school board. Also, I think in my looking at it, of any of the legislative bodies, I would go so far as to say there is not a Democratic or a Republican way to run schools. There might be a Republican and Democratic way to run a county or a city. I'm not too certain that same argument can be made for school boards.
So all the more reason why they should be running. I would agree with that, your last observation, Jim's last observation, which is there really is no political line that can be drawn. It can be drawn on a ballot, but in terms of approaching ELL students, students with special needs, there is no Republican versus Democratic way to handle that. So all the more reason why I think they should be competitive. I made the analogy between what happens in like city councils and town councils where we're not necessarily competitive, we run anyways, because I think it is an appropriate analogy. There's a debate that has to be had on a number of issues, and when you don't have Republicans, people saying they're not gonna run because they're not competitive, you don't get their point of view. I think that's unfortunate.
One school board candidate, Mia Hodgins, has run unsuccessfully as a Democrat in 2011, a Republican in 2013, and then again as a Democrat in 2015. She didn't win the primary election, so her name won't be on the general election ballot. But in 2013, she told the DNC editorial board that she's concerned the Democratic Party has held a monopoly on the school board for decades and has failed to provide results. She said it's time to forge bipartisan solutions to district problems. And if we look to the West, to our neighbors in Buffalo, they do. You will see Republicans on that school board. I invited Carl Paladino to join us. He wanted to be here, and he couldn't be here because of a scheduling conflict. But you do see that it's working there. And even during school board races, you see the GOP party in Buffalo, in addition to the Democratic Party, really getting behind certain candidates. They're out there. They're in front of the media. They're putting out, you know, ads for these campaigns. So is there something that we could then learn from Buffalo?
I would argue no.
And let me, why do you say that?
Let me say this. And the particularly in Monroe County, the Democratic Party is relatively diverse to begin with. In fact, it's factionalized enough that it probably isn't functioning anymore as a single party. But I want to go a little bit farther to your main point of does this make any difference in the administration of schools? Mm-hmm. What I think, and this is my take having been on the board for one term at least and then observing, is school board politics is like a toxic waste dump, okay? And the more you're exposed to it, the more contaminated you're likely to become. Well, so why would we? So why would we want to add more toxicity to an already toxic process by having Republicans like Paladino in there, particularly given the framework of the most partisan thinking in politics today? Do we really want to do to a local school board what we see in Congress, what we see in Albany? You know, that sides are lockstep because of party or because of the polarization of party. Do you really want to polarize school board politics any more than it's already polarized in ways among the current members? So I would say my experience is that whether it's the towns or whether it's the city, at some point, school board politics is very toxic. You do not want to add to that toxicity.
Let me say, I don't want to turn this into a CNN talking heads debate, but I think this is actually a healthy discussion. Yeah. I disagree vehemently.
Explain that, yep.
I think Jim may be cynical. It may be a reflection of his experiences. My experience, I've been on the board twice as long as Jim has. I've seen three superintendents, and I got to tell you, there are moments where there are disagreements, passionate disagreements. But by and large, if you stick in there and you hang in there, we were talking about this out in your green room, you develop relationships, whether they're Republican, conservative, Democrat. There, by the way, it's a well-hidden secret, there are school board members now who were Republicans, right? So what brings us together, this Board of Education, is the length of our service, the commonality of our mission. And so if you bring a Republican on, if that happens in this district, I'm convinced that that would be a person who, like my six colleagues, believes in the value of our mission. It is like a glue that you can't experience, I think, on city council, because when you're talking about children's people's children and their futures, it brings together people in ways that you just cannot even imagine. I'll go one step further. I think if you're on it long enough, you develop relationships. I'll really be very detailed about this. I think this current Board of Education, which has been in place for quite a while, there'll be very little change, we think, next week. We had one member step down. All the other incumbents are on the list as Democratic candidates. We're like a family. Look at our votes. Look at even the critical conversations we've had about governance, about the superintendent. We're lock and step together. It's not a coercive environment. And there are a couple reasons behind it. And none of it has to do with us being all Democrats. It has to do with us understanding the importance of our mission. I have a lot of respect for this guy, but I would not describe it as a toxic environment. And if a Republican was fortunate enough to get on the school board, I think he or she in time would become part of that family.
Do you think if a Republican did get on the school board, though, because the majority is Democratic, that their votes, their ideas, the things that they want to bring to the table then would be voted down because they're in the minority?
Well, look. First off, I'm not in total disagreement with what Van said, because I went through a board that went through transitions too, but. It depends upon what the person is bringing to the table. Sure. Today's partisan environment is, for the most part, too hyper-partisan, too polarizing, and has a tendency to get too much into the gutter politics. All you have to do
is... Are you talking about our board, right?
I'm talking about Republicans and Democrats. Okay. I'm talking about the introduction of... Okay. of the type of partisanship. We're not talking about the liberal Rockefeller Republicans anymore. We're not talking about, you know, thoughtful liberal Democrats either. If you are a true partisan, you are more likely nowadays to be on the extreme side rather than the moderate side. And bringing that type of partisanship in to a body that I do believe is inclined to ultimately break down in their working relationships, even if it's, you know, even if it's only occasionally. You know, as we were talking outside, the main reason you guys are really together now, or one of them, is because you're removing a superintendent that you feel is no longer functioning well. Trust me, that kind of unity, that will bring unity.
I want to ask about that, but sure. We need to close. Yeah. We hear, as we know, Superintendent Bolhan Vargas resigned this week. He himself was a Democrat on the school board. The superintendent of schools is generally not considered a political position at all, certainly not elected by the public to that position. But does political affiliation at all, when it comes to a superintendent candidate, impact their viability for the position?
No. Okay. One ever asked that question. Nope. But I want to get to your last question really quickly. The mechanics of how a Republican would be brought in. We operate, I don't know if this is the way it was when Jim was on there, we operate by committees. And each board member is assigned a committee, finance, governance, intergovernmental relations. It wouldn't make any difference what your affiliation is. Each board member becomes a chairperson of a committee. In terms of school assignments, we're all liaison to schools. It wouldn't make any difference whether you're Republican or Democrat or Independent or Green Party. You'd be assigned a school. That's how we operate. We don't operate by affiliation. And same thing with the superintendent. Nobody asked during an interview, are you Republican, Democrat, Conservative, Independent?
Jim Bowers and Van White, thank you both for your time and for your insight. I appreciate it. So what do you think of this issue? Share your thoughts and your perspective. Join the conversation on Twitter at hashtag NTKWXXI. And be sure to vote on Tuesday, November 3rd. That's next week. The polls are open from 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. And you can get election results and analysis right here on WXXI starting at 9 o'clock on election night. So tune in to WXXI Radio, AM 1370, and WXXINews.org. There are movies that serve as a distraction, a quick break from reality, mere entertainment. And then there are films that change the way we look at history, the issues of life, and even our own work and our own creative process. The latter is how American film master Martin Scorsese has described the influence of Polish cinema on his own films, in particular, Polish movies from the 1950s. The deep roots of Polish cinema continue to impact film directors, actors, and audiences around the globe. And an upcoming Polish Film Festival, now in its 18th year in Rochester, is highlighting classic Polish cinema. To share more about the stories of personal struggles, happiness, history, and hope are Randy Stone, director of the Skolny Center for Polish and Central European Studies at the University of Rochester, and Bożena Sabaluska, Skolny Center Program Coordinator and the organizer of the upcoming film festival. And it's great to have both of you here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us here.
So 18 years, a long time for this festival to be in Rochester. And I want to know, for people who are new to Polish cinema, have never experienced a film before, how do you hook them in and reel them in and say, these are films of importance, and here's why. This is a way that this film could influence you or impact you. How do you do it?
One thing I might point out is that there are a lot of misconceptions about East European films. We think of them as being old and black and white and very dour and all about communism, right? And contemporary Polish cinema is very different. It's wide-ranging. It reflects the vibrant democratic society of Poland today. And so we have a wide range of things. So really something for almost every taste, from a documentary about a transgender woman to historical dramas to a detective thriller, so really a wide range of offerings that reflect the diversity of the culture they're coming from.
And Poland, as I mentioned in the introduction, has a rich history in film. And I've read that in the late 1800s, Poland had a number of inventors, some working on creating their own version of a motion picture camera. And I'm curious to know, are there any quaint facts or interesting tidbits about Polish film that might be interesting to audiences that they may not be familiar with?
You mean how the films were made, or
how they stand out? For Martin Scorsese to be able to say, this has had such an influence on me and my work, what is it about these films that have been empowering, do you think, for film directors and audiences as well?
Well, you know, the film, the cinema in Poland has different stages. As you mentioned, in the 50s, it was a great period of Polish movies, very influencing on others. There were also next decades, like 60s and 70s and 80s, that great masters of Polish cinema created films. Then there was a period of depression and crisis in Polish cinema, mainly because of lack of funding, because the state funding ended at the end of the communistic system in Poland, and there was nothing else. Then in 2005, the Polish Film Institute was created, which provides funding for grants for film production and also film promotion. And because of that, actually, the film in Poland again thrives. And there are filmmakers that are famous again around the globe, actually. And like recently, Polish film got an Oscar for Polish for foreign films. You know, so what is special about these films, I think, is that they are really good, and there is a lot of things that people can connect with in them, and they can be funny, they can be very serious, you know, they can be thrillers, as Randy mentioned. So there is a lot of things that people can really like in these movies.
Well, I know that the theme for this year's festival, you mentioned people connecting with the stories of struggle and hope, the universal theme here. Why select this theme in particular for this year's festival? And I guess, how are you hoping that local audiences here who come to the festival will connect with that?
Well, we're hoping that it will offer something for people with a wide range of interests. So, for example, we're giving a little hors d'oeuvre on Sunday afternoon, which is a remastered version of the classic film The Deluge, which is based on Henrik Sienkiewicz's novel about the war between Sweden and the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth in the 17th century. And it's a romantic, big picture. It was an epic kind of film. It's been shortened a little bit, which fits better the preferences of modern audiences, and remastered and so forth. We have one more classic film on the opening night on Wednesday, Illumination, which again was a film made in 1973 and was kind of a touchstone for a generation of Poles. One of those films that just caught on. And it's about a scientist and his struggles with coming to understand himself and so forth. Then on Thursday night, we'll have a new film called Warsaw 44, which was directed by Jan Komasa, who's been here before as a guest, and he'll be back again. And so he'll be able to discuss the film afterwards with the audience on Thursday night. And that, again, is a big production where he's been doing historical research for a number of years to track down all the survivors of the, this is the Polish Warsaw Uprising in 1944, not to be confused with the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising of the previous year. But this is the one that happened just as the German lines were beginning to crumble and the Soviet army was advancing, and the Poles rose up in determination that they were going to free their own country and be an independent nation after the war. And of course, the Soviet army stopped on the river and didn't intervene, and the result was catastrophe and the tragic destruction of Warsaw and of the resistance fighters. But it's a stunning, beautiful film. And then there are a whole series of contemporary films that come on the weekend, and there's just a wide variety of different topics. So we're hoping that this idea will connect to different people in different ways.
Bojana, I understand that, and this would be, I think, something interesting for audiences to know, you actually personally traveled to Poland to screen the films that will be presented at this festival. Why was it important for you to actually go and do that as opposed to watching from your laptop at home?
I wouldn't be able to watch it from the laptop at home because these are very new films that are not yet on DVDs, on Blu-rays or whatever. Actually, one of the films that we are showing this year will have its American premiere here in Rochester. And so I am going every year since 8 years, I think. To Gdynia to attend the National Polish Film Festival there. Actually, I am invited there to see these movies that are best movies that's been recently produced and to be able to choose movies that I think would appeal to American audience here. Because I try to choose films that have kind of universal message, you know, not only dealing with very Polish problems, but universal, so that people here can really, as I said, connect with these films and with their topics. And because of this cooperation with Gdynia Film Festival, we are having for the second time this year artistic director of this film festival coming here to attend some screenings.
Bojana Sobluska and Randy Stone, I thank you both for joining me today. The 2015 Polish Film Festival begins this Sunday, that's November 1st, at 3 p.m. at Dryden Theater. That's at the George Eastman Museum. Check out the details on your screen so you can learn about all the films being shown at this year's festival. It seems there are two types of jack-o'-lanterns. There are the ones you carve and leave on your front porch during this time of year. You may even put a candle inside your carved pumpkin for trick-or-treat night. And then there are the ones you display for all the world to see. Jack-o'-lanterns that look like sea serpents and dinosaurs lit up from head to toe. Innovation Trail reporter Jenna Flanagan at our partner station, WMHT, reports on what's called the Great Jack-o'-Lantern Blaze. It's a Hudson Valley event that has drawn more than 100,000 visitors from around the globe in years past. Check it out.
This is the Great Jack-o'-Lantern Blaze, and this is a display of more than 7,000 hand-carved illuminated jack-o'-lanterns lit up throughout the landscape of Van Cortlandt Manor. And it's not just single carvings. These are very elaborate constructions. We have a spider web that's 50 foot around that's made up of more than 200 carvings. We have dinosaurs. We have a sea serpent. We have all sorts of things here. We go way beyond your typical, triangle nose and eyes kind of thing. We have a very small team of about 20 artists who do all of the work that you're seeing. And they work under the direction of Michael Nadiello, who's our creative director, but it's a very small team that does everything that you're seeing.
This year, we're at about 10,000 pumpkins for the whole season. Each week, we carve about 1,000 new ones to replenish the ones that have rotten. It's Halloween themed, and it's history inspired. We have the classic Halloween things, spider webs, ghosts, zombies, skeletons, but we also have 18th century decorative arts influences. So we have a whole showcase of 18th century Pierce creamware designs into pumpkins. So we're trying to make connections to the history of the place, the history of the family, the area. Another case in point, the Irish immigration that took place in the late 1800s. Brought with them this idea of the jack-o'-lantern. So previous to that, many people, if anybody, carved jack-o'-lanterns during Halloween. But it's an Irish tradition, and specifically a New York Hudson Valley tradition that kind of spread from there.
That was Jenna Flanagan of our partner station, WMHT, reporting. You can check out the 7,000 pumpkin carvings for yourself. Go to hudsonvalley.org/events/blaze for directions and ticket information. And that's it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Helene Biandudi-Hofer. Thanks for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend. And be sure to vote on Election Day. That's Tuesday, November 3rd. I'll see you next week right here on WXXI-TV.